Harper Via and Harper Audio present On Her Own, a novel by Lihi Lapid, translated from the Hebrew by Sandra Silverston, performed by Emily Lawrence. Daddy, my brother, I missed you for so long. Now I will miss you forever. 1. The sound of footsteps wakes her. She has no idea where she is, but she knows she shouldn't move. Her senses sharpen. The smell is unfamiliar. Carefully, she opens one eye to a narrow slit and sees soft red slippers, a nightgown hanging above them, moving down the steps toward her. Soundlessly, she curls up in a corner and tries to remember how she ended up in this stairwell. Her flashy minidress is scratchy, and she realizes she has no panties, so she presses her thighs together. She has no idea how many hours she's been here. She tries to open her eyes, but the glare of the fluorescent light is blinding. She closes them again. She wants to sleep some more. A lot more. To rest her head on the step again. To be oblivious. But that won't get her anywhere. And then she remembers. A place. That's what she needs. A place to be for the time being. He didn't believe that was what she'd do. And he told her so.
You can't be without me. You'll come crawling back, he said,
and laughed loudly with his friends, peeling away the last vestiges of her dignity. But you promised me, she pleaded. And he just sat there in the front seat, made the music louder, and lit a cigarette while the men in the back seat with her touched her, stroked her. I believed you, she whispered through her exhaustion, even though she knew he didn't hear, and pleaded again, Stop. Please. He lowered the volume of the raucous music and told her not to insult them.
They're not nice enough for you? They didn't act nice tonight?
He snickered. Then turning serious, he rebuked her.
What is it with you?
The too much aftershave guy, who always devoured her with his eyes, said to him,
Relax, Shmueli, it's okay. I've had tougher bitches than her.
Unzipped his fly and pushed her head down while the other one pulled off her panties. She tried to resist. He tore them. They stopped at a light. She felt like she was going to vomit. The light in the stairwell goes out.
Is someone here?
She hears the woman shuffling in the red slippers say in that old lady's voice that has amassed many years and memories. The light will go on again in a minute, so she takes advantage of the brief darkness to open her eyes and calculate the danger. She listens to the old lady dragging her feet to the light switch and tries to hold her breath. She needs more time to decide what to do, to understand where she is and where she'll go from here. She won't go back. No matter what. There's no place to go back to anyway. Definitely not to him. And not back home, either. She needs to think quickly about where she can go.
Is someone here?
The old lady asks again after she switches on the light, dazzling Nina, forcing her to cover her eyes, blinded to everything but the tattered red slippers of the sleepless old lady. And if only she'd go back to her apartment already, back to bed. She feels around for her evening bag or her phone and realizes that she didn't take anything when she ran away. Stupid idiot, she says to herself. As her eyes begin to adjust to the light, she takes a deep breath and tenses her body. She'll dash out to the street. And from there, it doesn't matter where. Just as long as that annoying old lady disappears and lets her wake up and think and decide what to do. But what annoys her most is that her mom was right. Shit, she curses. The light goes out again. The first rays of sun shatter on the glass door of the building, bathing the silhouette of the old lady in yellow. Now it's clear that the old lady sees her. She's trying to think of something to say when the old lady calls out to her happily.
Denna, what are you doing here, my mamushka?
Though Nina evades the sunbeams, she realizes that that's it. She's really screwed. Now it's not just the old lady, but also some Denna who'll turn up in another minute. She looks around, trying to figure out where this Denna is supposed to be coming from, before the old lady sees she's not anyone's Denna and calls the police, and she gets even more screwed. She has to get away from here. But before she can figure out what's going on and do something, the old lady comes over and throws her arms around her.
Denna,
she says joyfully, and then moves Nina's face away to examine it close up.
Denna, my Denna, she says. You're here. You came back to me.
Nina lowers her head, trying to hide her face with her disheveled hair. Just don't let this old lady turn on the light again, she wishes silently. Her head is exploding.
It'll be the end of you,
Shmueli shouted at her back as she ran away.
You think you'll manage here without me? And who will you call, eh? Who'll help you? Just wait, you'll beg me.
And that was it. She didn't hear anymore. She doesn't know what hurts her more now. Her heart, or her cheekbone where he slapped her when she said she didn't want to sit in the back with them, and he told her she didn't understand how much that disrespected his friends. She'd already seen many slaps in her life, in movies and also in reality. Some of her girlfriends got slapped more than once by their parents. She just never imagined it hurt so much. Soon, when she looks in the mirror, she'll see the black and blue mark on her forehead as well, and won't even remember how she got it. Whether someone else hit her, or maybe she banged her head on the door, trying to get away from them. She curses the day they met, the day she thought was the luckiest day in her life. Until now. She always knew she was beautiful. It was something she grew up with. The way some kids have a blanket, or a ball, or a dad. Like all girls, when she got to be a teenager, she began to see her flaws and thought all the other girls were more than her. More beautiful, or more clever, or their hair was always perfect, or their breasts were bigger than her very small ones. But with time, she couldn't help but feel what happened to people when they looked at her. The older women, the ones who had always hugged her and pinched her cheek when she was a child, or handed her a piece of candy and spit three times against the evil eye, tfu, tfu, tfu. They stopped touching her, didn't go near her anymore. The warmth in their gazes and the smiles on their faces disappeared too. And the more distant they grew, those older women, the closer the girls in her class came, trying to understand, to touch, to feel it close up, to learn how to acquire a bit of that breathtaking thing for themselves. Then the boys came closer, as if she were a bowl of honey. And then the older guys began to buzz around her, at first with puffed-out chests, then with motorcycles. And then the men who got out of cars some kid had polished for a few pennies began to look at her, trying to steal her attention. Some of them attempted to trap her in their shiny, humming webs, to tie her up with their ropes and, for a moment, hold on to the feeling that they could possess that rare thing. And she saw the sweat of their efforts on them. There were also the men who only looked at her, but didn't try to possess her or get close to her, knowing they didn't stand a chance. The same way she looked at the expensive brand names displayed in the shop windows at the mall. They looked at her with the knowledge that she would never be theirs. It wouldn't happen to them. The kind of man who had already suffered enough blows in life and knew his place. Who walked behind his wife in the shopping center, sometimes holding her small handbag on his arm. The kind of man who, looking at her, recalled his youth with a sense of having missed out. mostly because of some girl to whom he hadn't dared tell his feelings a long time ago. They were the men who had the look in their eyes that saw what she tried so hard to hide. The child in her. A look that peeled away the thorns and exposed the vulnerability. The male look that always prompted her mother to use the expression Nina hated so much, "He's a good man." "Who needs a good man?" she would say, laughing at her silently, sometimes out loud, as they sat at the greenish formica table in the narrow kitchenette that could hold only the two of them, and even that was a tight squeeze. And her mother would say, "I do." "A good man isn't so important, Mom. You don't understand anything," she told her. "What you need is a strong man, a man with power." She didn't tell her how much she dreamed about that man who would come to take her away from here, who would start his car and whisk her away to another place. No, he wouldn't be a good man, she knew. She had no illusions about that. But she was smart. She already knew something about this world, and she thought she'd use him no less than he would use her. Use him to fly far away from here. And look, he came. She only had to touch him sometimes, and that was okay. Shmueli, whose friends called him Johnny, was so excited that it was over quickly. And she was excited by the intense feeling that she had power over him. How addicted he was to her hands, to her touch. He followed her to school. He would pick her up in the morning to take her there, just to have those 5 minutes with her. He would leave Ofra in front of the TV in the evening and drive over for a quick visit. "Just come down to the car for a minute," he'd say. At first, he didn't need a lot. Just her hand. Sometimes her mouth a little. Then he began to touch her under her clothes, and it took him longer. That's why he wanted to have her for a whole night. Her mother sat across from her, rubbing the table with the rough tips of her fingers, cleaning away more and more invisible crumbs. Then she reached up to her head, took out the clips, and let her beautiful, full head of hair land gently on her shoulders. And for the first time, Nina saw how much gray streaked her hair and how much the original wheat color had faded. It needed to be washed, they both knew.
"It's not a good idea,"
Arena told her in despair, trying to stop a train that had left the station a long time ago. When Arena was Nina's age, she too thought she knew better. Better than anyone. In the end, she turned out to be an idiot. Now she's here, alone with her daughter, who thinks she knows better and doesn't understand that she doesn't. She only just turned 18, and she's smart. It's not that she isn't, but not as smart as she thinks. And for a while now, from afar, you could see the word trouble engraved on her. A large warning sign written on her beauty. Because Nina was much more beautiful than she had been at her age, when she was an idiot. She'd been a good-looking idiot. Her Nina was more beautiful than her. Too beautiful. Nina had fought it for years. As a child, she tried so hard to keep people from seeing only that, tried to hide it, to cover her face with her hair.
"Let me see you,"
Shmueli said, holding her face after he'd pushed away her hair, coming a bit too close. A lot too close. "You promised you wouldn't touch," she said.
"Right,"
he replied.
"And I always keep my promises. So I won't touch, but maybe you will."
And he pulled her hand toward his groin.
"Only if you want to," he said with a laugh. "You don't have to."
But in the end, she had to. Not that day, but 2 days later, when it was almost dawn and she was so tired and she knew she had an exam that morning and was eager to go home and take a shower. She touched his pants there, and he pressed her hand down with his own really, really hard, and she heard his breathing in her ear, and the panting and the groaning, and she didn't want to see his face contorting. He told her that now he was dirty because of her, that he had a better idea for the next time, one that would leave him clean.
You don't understand. You just don't understand, her mother said angrily during that conversation after Shoshi at the daycare center told her the name of the person she was running around with. You're a child. What business do you have with that man? He loves me. Loves you? Wants you, maybe, not loves you. He loves me. Do you love him? He loves me. That's not what I asked. Yes, I do. You don't. And he doesn't love you either. You're nothing to him. He's just using you. He'll toss you away like an old rag.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.